السابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم بإحسان.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، so I think we arrived at the hadith last time where it was mentioned from Ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما. He said, لم أرى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يستلم من البيت غير الركنين اليمانيين. That I did not see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam greet or receive any of the corners of the Kaaba except the two Yemeni corners. This is from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that when going around the Kaaba, it is only the Yemeni corner and the black stone corner, those two corners that are touched, and there are no other corners or any other sides where anything is done. فهذه هي السنة أنه لا يمسح من البيت إلا الركن اليماني والحجر الأسود، أما الركن العراقي وركن الشام وهما الركنان الشماليان من الكعبة فلا يستلمان ولا يقبلان. As for the other two corners, then they are not touched, they are not kissed. And the wisdom behind that perhaps, والحكمة في ذلك والله أعلم، أن الركن اليماني وركن الحجر الأسود على قواعد إبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام. And maybe the wisdom behind that is because the Yemeni corner and the black stone corner, they are upon the original foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. As for the other two corners, then they are not upon the original foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Because when Quraysh had rebuilt the Kaaba, they fell short with their funds and they were unable to complete it upon the full original foundations, and so they built it short of where it was originally. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned in a hadith to Aisha radiyallahu anha, لولا أن قومك حديثو عهد بجاهلية لهدمت الكعبة وعدتها على قواعد إبراهيم. That was it not for the fact that your people are new to Islam. They have only just left their old days and they have just entered into Islam. Then otherwise I would have taken down the Kaaba and rebuilt it upon the original foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. لذلك تركها درءا للفتنة فالعمل الفاضل إذا ترتب عليه فتنة فإنه يترك درءا لها فبقيت على بناء قريش. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not take it down and rebuild it again, and that is because the people were new to Islam at the time, and there would have been a fitna if he was to take down the Kaaba. So he did not do so, and the Kaaba remained. from that time up until now on the foundations that Quraysh managed to build it up to. And then there is a semicircle now there indicating where the original foundations of the Kaaba were up to. So it would have originally been a rectangular kind of shape, but they didn't finish it up to the original foundations, the Quraysh at that time. So then the new hadith عن عمر رضي الله عنه أنه قبل الحجر الأسود فقال إني أعلم أنك حجر لا تضر ولا تنفع ولولا أني رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقبلك ما قبلتك. In this narration, Umar radiallahu anhu mentions that he kissed the black stone and then he said, verily I know that you are only a stone and you cannot harm nor benefit. And was it not for the fact that I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam kissing you, then I would not have kissed you. Muttafaqun alayhi, the hadith is in al-Bukhari and Muslim. Fi hadha al-hadith, anna amir al-mu'minin Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu qabbala al-hajar al-aswad, يعني في أثناء الطواف, فدل على أن تقبيله في كل شوط من أشواط الطواف سنة إذا أمكن ذلك. أمير المؤمنين عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه, in this narration it mentions he kissed the black stone and that was during tawaf. When he was doing tawaf, then when he got to the black stone, he would kiss it. So this indicates it is a sunnah to kiss the black stone when going around in tawaf. When you come to the black stone, to kiss it, as Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu did, if a person is able to do so. Of course, there's a lot of crowding, etc., so it may not be possible, but if a person is able to physically kiss the black stone, then that is a sunnah in every circuit of your tawaf, every time you go around. وَإِنْ لَمْ يُمْكِنْ فَإِنَّهُ يُشِيرُ إِلَيْهِ إِذَا حَاذَاهُ وَيُكَبِّرُ. And if it's not possible to kiss it, then when you're going around in the tawaf and you come in line with where the black stone is, then you point to it with your hand and say Allahu Akbar. وَيَكْفِي ذَٰلِكَ عَنِ اسْتِلَامِهِ وَتَقْبِيلِهِ. So in those circumstances when you're not able to physically touch it and kiss it, you simply make the indication towards it and then say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and that is sufficient. That covers you and you don't have to make sure you go and touch it. If you're unable, you just make that indication and say the takbir and continue. فالمشروع في الحجر استلامه باليد, يعني مسحه باليد, ثم تقبيله إذا أمكن, وإلا فإنه يشير إليه لأنه من سنن الطواف. So what should be done if you're able is to physically touch it and kiss it. But if you're not able because of the crowding, then you indicate towards it, and that is sufficient then. وَتَقْبِيلُ الْحَجَرِ عِبَادَةٌ لِلَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Kissing the black stone, it is an act of worship. It is an act of worship to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. لِأَنَّهُ مِنْ مَشَاعِرِ اللَّهِ فَتَقْبِيلُهُ عِبَادَةٌ لِلَّهِ لَا عِبَادَةٌ لِلْحَجَرِ وَإِنَّمَا الْحَجَرُ مَعْلًا وَمَشْعَرٌ مِنْ مَشَاعِرِ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. So when you kiss the black stone, you are not doing worship to the stone itself. Rather, kissing the black stone is an implementation of the sunnah and a worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not worship of the stone. You are not kissing the stone and touching it to worship it. Rather, you are kissing it and touching it to worship Allah and to implement the sunnah of doing so. فَكَمَا أَنَّ الْوُقُوفَ بِعَرَفَةِ وَمُزْدَلِفَةِ عِبَادَةِ لِلَّهِ لِأَنَّهَا مَحَلُّ عِبَادَةِ وَكَذَلِكَ الطَّوَافُ بِالْكَعْبَةِ لَيْسَ هُوَ مِنْ أَجْلِ الْكَعْبَةِ وَإِنَّمَا هُوَ مِنْ أَجْلِ اللَّهِ. So just like when you go to Arafah and you go to Muzdalifah and you go to those various places, they are places to conduct your worship in. You are worshipping Allah, you're not worshipping the places. And the same when you do tawaf, you're not worshipping the Kaaba. That is just the place and the location upon which you conduct that act of worship. It is not the place you are worshipping, it's not the Kaaba you are worshipping. You are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that location, doing the tawaf around the Kaaba. فكذلك استلام الحجر أو تقبيله والإشارة إليه عبادة لله سبحانه وتعالى. ولهذا بين عمر رضي الله عنه أنه إنما يقبله اقتداء برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So عمر بن الخطاب, when he kissed the black stone, and it mentions in the hadith that some of the mushrikun were there. Some of the mushrikun were there. And they saw Umar ibn al-Khattab kissing the black stone. So he wanted to clarify to those mushrikun the reality of Tawheed and the reality of Islam and the worship of Allah alone. And that he's not worshipping the stone just like they worship their stones and their idols and their statues. So he clarified this action and made clear the matter of Tawheed, and said that I know you are just a stone, you cannot harm and you cannot benefit. And was it not for the fact the messenger kissed you, I saw him kissing you, then I wouldn't have kissed you. Meaning the only reason I'm doing it is not to worship you, but to implement the sunnah, to implement and follow in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the reason. It is an implementation of the sunnah. It is therefore a worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the reason. Not because I'm worshipping you or that you can harm or that you can benefit. وَالدِّينُ بِالِاقْتِدَاءِ وَالِاتِّبَاعِ وَالْعِبَادَاتُ تَوْقِيفِيَّةِ لَا يُفْعَلُ شَيْءٌ مِّنْهَا إِلَّا بِدَلِيلٍ ولا يدخلها القياس والاستحسان إنما هي توقيفية فقط. So worship is something that can only be derived from the Quran and the Sunnah. It is not something you can think up yourself and work out yourself. This is worship, that is worship. No, it is only what you find in the evidences of the Quran and the Sunnah that is going to be considered worship, not something that you make a judgment, well, this looks like it should be worship, or something you think is good, the istihsan, you think it's good and suitable and this should be worship, not like that, but only what is found in the evidences. فَأَرَادَ عُمَرْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنْ يَنْفِيَ بِذَلِكَ مَا يَعْلَقُ فِي أَذْهَانِ بَعْضٍ الجهال من التبرك بالحجر. So Umar ibn Khattab wanted to make it clear that seeking barakah from the black stone is not his intent, as some of the ignorant ones used to seek barakah from the stones and the trees and the idols and statues. He wanted to make it clear that this is not because you believe the stone can harm you or the stone can do good for you. And it's not about seeking barakah from the stone itself. Rather, it is a creation from the creations of Allah, that stone. The black stone, makhluq, min makhluqatillah. It is a creation from the creations of Allah. لَيْسَ بِيَدِهِ نَفْعٌ وَلَا ضَرٌ. There is no harm, no benefit the stone controls. وَلَا يُقَبَّلُ مِنْ أَجْلِ طَلَبِ النَّفْعِ أَوْ دَفْعِ الضَّرَرِ. And you do not kiss it, hoping to get some benefit from it, or for it to remove some harm from you. وَإِنَّمَا يُطْلَبُ هَذَا مِنَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. But that is only sought from Allah. The good is only sought from Allah, and the removal of harm is only sought from Allah. So what do we learn from this narration? Firstly, مَشْرُوعِيَّةُ تَقْبِيلِ الْحَجَرِ فِي الطَّوَافِ فِي كُلِّ شَوْطٍ مِّنْ أَشْوَاطِ الطَّوَافِ وَأَنَّ ذَلِكَ سُنَّةُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The legislation, the sunnah, to kiss the black stone during tawaf. Every circuit when you come around, to kiss it if you are able. And if not, to make the indication with your hand. Secondly, we also learn أَنَّ الْعِبَادَاتِ تَوْقِيفِيَّةِ. That all acts of worship are restricted to the evidences of the Qur'an and the sunnah. فَمَا دَلَّ عَلَيْهِ الدَّلِيلِ مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ أَخَذْنَا بِهِ وَمَا لَمْ يَدُلَّ عَلَيْهِ دَلِيلِ تَرَكْنَاهِ. Whatever we find in the evidences of the Qur'an and the sunnah, then we do that. And whatever we do not find, then we abandon that. Thirdly, نَفِي أَنَّ الْحَجَرْ تَنْفَعْ وَيَضُرْ أَوْ يَنْفَعْ وَيَضُرْ. A negation of the stone harming or benefiting. There is no harm nor benefit from the stone itself. It is a creation from the creations of Allah. Benefit and harm is in the control of Allah alone. وَكَذَلِكَ سَائِرُ الْمَخْلُوقَاتِ الْكَعْبَ وَمَقَامُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ وَالْحَجْرَ النَّبَوِيَّةِ وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكَ مِنَ الْأَمْكِنَةِ أَوِ الْأَبْنِيَةِ فَإِنَّهُ لَا تَأْثِيرَ لَهَا وَلَا تَمْلِكُ النَّفْعُ وَلَا الضُّرُّ وَإِنَّمَا ذَلِكَ بِيَدِ اللَّهِ. All of the various locations, the Kaaba itself, Maqami Ibrahim, the Prophet's home, the various other places, various other locations that people believe there is some goodness to those places and barakah in those places, and they control good for you or remove harm from you. They do not have any impact, any of these locations or places. Rather, Allah is the one who controls all of that. The fourth issue, أَنَّهُ لَا يُقَبَّلُ إِلَّا الْحَجَرُ الْأَسْوَدُ وَلَا يُتَمَسَّحُ إِلَّا بِهِ وَرُكْنُ الْيَمَانِ يُسْتَلَمُ فَقَطْ وَلَا يُقَبَّلُ. The black stone is the only corner of the Kaaba you try to kiss if you are able. The Yemeni corner, it is not kissed. The Yemeni corner is not kissed. You simply greet the Yemeni corner. A greeting is made for the Yemeni corner, but the kissing is not done except for the black stone. وَرُكْنُ الْيَمَانِ يُسْتَلَمُ فَقَطْ وَلَا يُقَبَّلُ وَأَمَّا الْحَجَرُ فَيُقَبَّلُ وَيُسْتَلَمُ لِأَنَّ الرُّكْنَ الْيَمَانِ لَهُ فَضِيلَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ وَهِيَ أَنَّهُ عَلَى قَوَاعِدِ إِبْرَاهِيمُ وَأَمَّا الْحَجَرُ الْأَسْوَدُ فَلَهُ مَزِيَّتَانِ. And that's because the Yemeni corner has one virtue, which is that it is upon the original foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So that is recognized in your tawaf when you go past it. As for the black stone, it has two distinguishing factors. مَزِيَّتَانِ. Firstly, that it is also upon the original foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and secondly, anna fihi al-hajar al-aswad, that in that corner you have within it the black stone, and the black stone in and of itself is virtuous. Alladhi huwa mash'arun min mashaa'ir Allah azza wa jalla, falidhalika sara yustalamu wa yuqabbal li hatayn al-fadilatayn وما عداهما من أركان الكعبة فإنه لا يستلم ولا يقبل، لأن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يفعل شيئا من ذلك مع بقية الأركان. وإذا كان هذا لا يشرع في أركان الكعبة غير الركنين اليمانيين، فغير أركان الكعبة من المباني والآثار من باب أولى، فلا يتبرك بها ولا يتمسح بها ولا تقبل، لأن هذا شرع ما لم يأذن به الله سبحانه وتعالى. So the black stone is kissed, the Yemeni corner is greeted, and all the other corners, the other two corners, nothing is done. And the other walls of the Kaaba, nothing is done. People, they start touching the walls and they start touching the other corners and they start touching everywhere and the cloth of the Kaaba. But all of the other sides of the Kaaba and the walls of the Kaaba, there is no barakah on the other sides and the walls of the Kaaba. There is a sunnah for one wall of the Kaaba, one specific section of the Kaaba that you can touch, and that is between the black stone and the door. You see the pictures of the door of the Kaaba, just next to it is the black stone. The black stone is just there on that corner, and then it's the door of the Kaaba. That section can be touched. That is in the sunnah that you touch that section with all of your body up against it. But all of the other areas, there is no sunnah that a person touches it and wipes it and takes the cloth away from it. There is nothing from the other sides and the other corners. Then in the next hadith he mentions, وَعَنْ أَبِي الطُّفَيْلِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالْ رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَطُوفُ بِالْبَيْتِ وَيَسْتَلِمُ الرُّكْنَ بِمِحْجَنٍ مَعَهُ وَيُقَبِّلُ الْمِحْجَنِ رواه مسلم. In this hadith, it is still talking about the kissing of the black stone, but it mentions Abu Tufail reports in this narration that he saw the Messenger of Allah doing tawaf around the Kaaba and touching the black stone with a stick and then kissing the stick. هذا الحديث الذي قبله أنه يستحب استلام الحجر الأسود يعني مسحه باليد وتقبيله إذا أمكن. So this is like the previous narration. It indicates touching and kissing the black stone if you're able. If you're not, وإلا فإنه يستلمه بواسطة آلة. Then you can use some tool to touch the black stone and then you kiss the tool. إما عصا وإما محجن. Either some type of stick or some type of walking stick or other type of branch, that you use that and then kiss that. And that is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did in this occasion. استلمه بيده الشريفة وقبله مرة ومرة ثانية أشار إليه بالمحجن. So the first time he actually touched it with his hand and kissed the black stone, and on the second occasion he simply indicated towards it with the stick and was not able to or did not touch it with his actual hand. لأنه صلى الله عليه وسلم طاف راكبا على راحلته فأشار يعني استلم الحجر بواسطة المحجن وهو نوع من العصي وقبل المحجن فدل على مشروعية هذا أو هذا. فإذا لم يتمكن من استلامه مباشرة وتقبيله ولا من استلامه بواسطة فإنه يشير إليه بيده اليمنى ولا يرفع يديه مثل ما يرفعهما عند تكبيرة الإحرام كما يفعل بعض الجهال. ليس هذا من السنة وإنما يرفع يده اليمنى فقط ويشير بها إليه فقط ويقول الله أكبر. So if a person cannot physically touch the black stone and kiss it, then you can use a stick, some form of stick or some type of item, and then you kiss the stick. And as the Prophet ﷺ did so, he was on his riding animal as he was doing the tawaf, so he reached over with his stick and then kissed the stick. And if a person cannot do that, and obviously these days that's almost impossible with sticks in there with so many people, then in that case you simply do the indication with your hand as we mentioned, and say Allahu Akbar. And do not raise your hands up as some of the people do, like you're about to start the prayer. When you say Allahu Akbar, some people they raise their hands like this, as though you're about to do the takbir for the prayer when they get to the black stone. It's not an imitation of how you raise your hands for the prayer. It's simply an indication to the black stone, not like the takbir as though you're about to start the prayer. Then in the next hadith, وَعَنْ يَعْلَى ibn أُمَيَّةِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالْ طَافَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ الضَّبِعًا بِبُرَدٍ أَخْضَرٍ رواه الخمسة إلا النسائي وصححه الترمذي. In this narration it mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did the tawaf in a green garment, muttabi', meaning that he had his shoulder and arm exposed. And we'll come to that here now. Al-ittiba' an yaj'ala wasat ar-rida' tahta katifayhi al-ayman ويجعل طرفيه على عاتقه الأيسر فيكون كتفه الأيمن مكشوفا. It is when you put the garment on so that it comes under your right armpit, so your right shoulder and arm are out, and the garment comes from under there and then over your left shoulder, so it's covering everywhere else, over the left shoulder, across your chest, and then coming under your right arm, so that the right arm is left out of the garment. So that is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it, with the right arm and shoulder exposed and the garment covering and wrapped around the rest of his body, including his left arm and shoulder. فَكَتِفُهُ الْأَيْسَرُ مَسْتُورًا بِالرِّدَاءِ. That is covered up with the garment. وَهَذَا هُوَ الْإِطْبَاعُ وَهُوَ إِخْرَاجُ الضَّبْعِ وَالضَّبْعُ الْعَضُدُ وَقِيلَ هُوَ مَا تَحْتَ الْإِبْطِ والإنسان ضبعان الضبع الأيمن والضبع الأيسر ففي الطواف يكشف الأيمن ويجعل الأيسر مستورا هذا هو الاطباع يكون ذلك في أول طواف القدوم أو طواف العمرة ويكون في جميع الأشواط مطبعا ولو لم يطبع وطاف مستور الكتفين جاز ذلك وصح طوافه لكن يكون تاركا لسنة من سنن الطواف. So that's how you're supposed to do the tawaf in all of the circuits. We mentioned about the ramal, the quick short footsteps. That's only in the first three circuits. But then the iltiba', uncovering the right arm and shoulder, that is for the whole of the tawaf. But if a person didn't do it, it's not a condition, the tawaf would still be valid. But you've missed out on one of the sunnahs of the tawaf. And you do not want to be missing out on any of the sunnahs when you are doing Umrah and Hajj. وَأَمَّا فِي طَوَافِ الْإِفَاضَةِ فَإِنَّهُ يَطُوفُ بِثِيَابِهِ كَمَا سَبَقَ لِأَنَّهُ تَحَلَّلَ وَالتَّحَلُّلُ الْأَوَّلُ وَلَبِسَ ثِيَابَهُ وَإِنْ قَدِرَ أَنْ يَطُوفَ بِإِحْرَامِهِ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَطَّبِعْ لِأَنَّ هَذَا خَاصٌ بِالطَّوَافِ الْقُدُومِ وَطَوَافِ الْعُمْرَةِ الطَّوَافُ الْأَوَّلُ أَوَّلُ مَا يَقْدَمُ إِلَى مَكَّةَ. And that, when you uncover the right arm, is only in the initial tawaf. If you're doing Umrah, of course there's just one tawaf anyway, so you do that in it. If you're doing Hajj, your first initial tawaf of arrival, you do that. But then the tawafs afterwards, you don't do that. That uncovering of the right arm in Hajj is only in the first initial tawaf of arrival. The other tawafs afterwards, you're going to be in your normal clothes anyway, most likely. But if you aren't, and you do the tawaf al-ifada, etc. in your ihram still, you will not be uncovering your right arm in those other tawafs afterwards. It is only the initial tawaf upon arrival. The narration also mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wearing a green garment. في رداء أخضر دليل على أنه لا بأس بأي لون من الألوان لأن الإحرام لا يشترط فيه لون معين وإنما يلبس على ما جرت عادة الرجال بلبسه أخضر أو أبيض أو أسود إلا الأحمر الخالص فإنه لا يجوز للرجال لبسه، وأما بقية الألوان فيجوز للرجل لبسه إذا كان من عادة الرجال لا من عادة النساء.
There is no condition that the ihram has to be white. There is no condition for that. So it could be any color that is from the norms of the people. And of course, now it has become the absolute norm of everyone that you wear white. But any color, technically speaking, that is from the norms of the people would be valid. It's not a condition that the ihram garments have to be white. So the Prophet ﷺ on this occasion actually wore green. He was wearing green garments as his ihram. So any color is possible if it is from the norms of the people for the men to wear, apart from pure red, which is impermissible, or any other types of colors that would be considered from the colors of the women, that would be impermissible. But any other colors that the men wear, then it is permissible in the garments of ihram. However, as we've said, these days it has become known and widespread that the men simply wear white. فَإِنَّهُ يَجُوزُ لِلْرِجَالِ لِبْسُهُ Men can wear any other color that is from the traditions and the norms, except pure red or anything that is resemblant of the women's garments. And that is because it is impermissible to wear garments that resemble the clothing of the women. But otherwise, any other color that is appropriate can be worn in the ihram. It is not a condition that it has to be white. That's where we'll have to round off today on a slightly shorter lesson because of the prayer times. We'll continue next week then. It will be at the same earlier start. We'll try and start as close as possible to 6 p.m., 10 past 6, inshallah ta'ala, to get more time before the Isha. So we'll conclude upon that for today. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ عَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ